talking about Benford's law a little bit more today, and then percentiles. Was actually released a couple days ago. Clearly, I forgot to update this slide with the current date. One thing to comment, I've had a number of kind of like emails or whatever about attendance, you know, somebody's sick or whatever. Please make sure you include Graham on any messages like that, because if you just include me, it is likely I will not get a chance to respond to you. So just kind of make sure we include both of us. The related detail is, don't forget the first version of the syllabus had the wrong email address for Graham. So make sure you have the correct email address. Any questions so far? I think I'm not sure how many events are left on the CDS event schedule, but I think there's a couple. So if you want to try to get that extra credit, make sure you attend one of those soon if you want to do that. All right, so here is an example of Benford's law, sort of. But to start off with, here is a piece of text that was floating around. It was a general theme, and you know, like there was a bunch of different sources for this. But here was kind of an often quoted, blurb, for lack of a better term. And so, what I want to point out here is a couple things. So, the way this is like laid out and with the color and all that stuff, like I had nothing to do with it. So it's all directly in the original content. Okay. So what I want to ask all of you is whether you agree with this or disagree with this is kind of irrelevant to the point I'm trying to make. But what I want to point out is some problems with this text. Okay. So when you're kind of looking at, kind of data science answers from people, you kind of want to look at it, like, as we said before, like kind of like a scientist, right? So you want to think about what the message they're trying to get across and why, that content is the way it is. So reading this, does anyone notice anything special about it? Like anything that would cause you to look at it and say, hey, maybe they're trying to get me to think a certain way. Right. Okay. So those are two things. So basically what the author is trying to do, right, is call out certain things, almost like they're trying to signal some other kind of messaging inside the existing message. Right. So the things that are called out in color, will stand out for a reader more, right? Things that are capitalized will stand out for a reader more. And so those are the things that you'll tend to focus on as a reader of English. Has anybody ever read a contract, like a US-based contract for, legal things? Is there something weird about them that is different than normal writing?
They're usually very, very specific.
Okay, but there's another, just in this straight up how the text looks.
I'm not sure.
Okay, so there's lots and lots of fully capitalized things. So like, there will be entire sentences, for example, that are in all caps. Does anybody know why that might be? It makes you pay attention to certain sentences, not just because it's caps, but because when it's all caps, you actually read it more slowly. You are actually, like, physically, when you try to read something that's in all caps, it's slower to read, and therefore you tend to take it in more. So using those kind of two pieces of data, right? So you can see that the callouts here, so like vote and violate and tallies and looking for the other weird capitalization, but those are in the State Department here, right? Those are the things they're trying to call out. Do you know something else?
Something else, this will come back to that.
So that's really interesting. I have no idea if you are correct. So I'm going to assume that you are. But so the argument is basically that red will actually help you recall it better. And so that stands to, that seems plausible to me, right? That would be a good choice for red. Anything else? How about the English in general? Yeah. Yeah, so this is the general election. Yeah. It certainly implies that there are actually other candidates in the general election in the U.S., just that usually their vote counts are so small that they don't, you know, kind of really matter that much. But there are technically other candidates, so it's not technically inaccurate, but it's interesting that they call it out, right? One in 10 dentists recommend this toothpaste. So exactly, that's one of the things I point out as well. Anything else? Any other ideas? All right, so I'll show you the list I came up with. All right, so some analysts, kind of to your point, like who? Tallies in State Department, you know, why are these highlighted? What is that trying to tell us? So that one we talked about already. Violate, why is this capitalized? So violate obviously has a very negative connotation type word, right? Yeah.
I just realized, if you look, they're kind of making like a headline almost. Some analysts, and this is where the headline begins, Biden's vote tallies violate Fetcher's law.
Right.
All those words are capitalized, like so they want you to read that more slowly and enunciate it or something.
Right. So yeah. Like, do I have that in here? So exactly. There's all kinds of subtlety going on in this thing, right? Is that you clearly know that this is authored by somebody who is actively trying to convince you of something, even though it's sort of written as if a reporter or an independent third party, right, had actually written it. So a couple other things that I pointed out too, accepted test for catching election fraud, what accepted test? Does anybody know what the accepted test is for capturing election fraud? Because if the State Department had actually come up with it, mind you, the State Department has nothing to do with election fraud at all. So why would they come up with it? What forensic accountants and where, like according to what forensic accountant group, et cetera, et cetera, right? So it's just kind of like when you're looking at this stuff, you know, make sure you're reading it critically. Because it's really important that you actually understand what they're trying to get across versus what they might be trying to do. So does anybody remember this story at all? Okay, so basically there was this whole thing. And so some background. So basically, 70% of the votes in Milwaukee were for Biden. Half of all the wards. Okay, so a ward is a unit in a district, which is in a county, which is then in a state. And so the smallest unit kind of the election counting in the U.S. is a ward. So that's what a ward is here. And so the total votes were from about 570 to 1,200, and the logarithmic average of the mean is about 800. The U.S. is essentially a two-party system at the national level, to your earlier point. However, technically speaking, it's not. So just kind of give you a little bit of background if you're not terribly familiar with U.S. politics. So here's the proof, okay? So this curve, the red curve, right, is the Benford's law distribution, or what you would expect to see if this data followed Benford's law. So as you can see, Biden is wildly different from Benford's law, whereas Trump is pretty close, right? And then here's some other candidates that are basically, you know, had very small vote counts, but they are from not those two big parties. So this seems to prove them correct, right? However, what do you think? Is this an indication of voter fraud? Not that I set it up at all. So, sort of, like, technically that's correct, but there's a worse reason. Any other ideas? All right, so the part I will point out in particular is this bit here, okay? Which is that the range is only 570 to 1,200. And if you remember from last time, and this is a little easier when I have these two pieces of the lecture together, is that it doesn't work because what we talked about last time is that this Benford's law only works well when you have orders of magnitude differences in the range of numbers. Okay? So does anybody know what orders of magnitude differences in the range means? What's an order of magnitude? Anybody remember? All right, so an order of magnitude is basically adding zeros. Okay, so like if you have 10 and you have 100, those are two different orders of magnitude, okay? So because the numbers are so close together, that whatever it was, 800 to 1200, there's not enough fluctuation in the vote count totals to work with Benford's law. So in fact, there's actually been literally decades of research trying to use Benford's law to predict elections or to validate election fraud, that kind of thing, that hasn't worked. And this is a quote that I probably have in the attributions, but I can't remember who it's from, from a data scientist who's like, nope, not at all. This just is not true. And so the point of this story is not only critical thinking is really important when you're kind of reading anything related to quote unquote science, right? But then also that not all tools apply in all cases, okay? In the US education system for young kids now, one of the things that they teach, I forget what it's called now, it has some buzzwordy name. And most of you might have been in it if you did the US education system. But instead of teaching, say, math by adding and subtracting and memorizing tables and stuff like that, there's this strong tendency to actually teach things like pattern matching first, okay? And I can't remember the name of it. But so there's this whole, like, theory of how to teach that's been adopted largely in the U.S. in, like, kind of elementary school. And most parents hate it. Because they can't help their kids with their math, for example, because they weren't taught this way, right? So, however, speaking as somebody who kind of thinks about this kind of problem a lot, I think it's brilliant. Because basically, like, when one of my kids was taught to do, like, addition and subtraction and multiplication and division, they were actually taught various techniques to solve those problems that only work sometimes. And then eventually they were taught the universal mechanism, which is super interesting because it actually makes you think about, I have an algorithm, I have another algorithm, and I have another algorithm, but not all the algorithms work all of the time. And that is very, very true in all of data science, okay? And this is just one great example of where Benford's law looks like it should work here, right? Except that it cannot, because the whole proof is around the fact that the number separation has to be orders of magnitude different. And so when we were looking at the counties last time, Tuesday, we saw that it did work because the county sizes were so wildly different. Whereas with wards, kind of the point of a ward for elections, right, is that they are similar in size, if that makes sense. And so that's why they're broken to about the size they are. And yeah, I don't know. So that's the point of this story. So in fact, this is And then a little bit more. Oh, I did put it here. I thought so. So if you find this interesting, which I thought was really interesting, here are some articles and some papers about it. Or if you prefer to listen to things, this Radiolab podcast. If you haven't listened to Radiolab, it's actually really good in general about lots of different stuff. And there's actually a whole Netflix like documentary series, and one of the episodes is about this particular problem. So if you like to read, if you like to listen, or if you like to watch, there's some ways to pursue this some more if you're interested. And so basically this is a counterexample to Benford's law. All right, so moving on. Let's see, do we have any questions? So we'll move on, we'll talk about percentiles. And the reason we're gonna talk about percentiles, I think most of you probably know what the word percentile means, but we mean something very specific in this case. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna talk about how we compute percentiles and what it means in the context of kind of data science, okay? So what's the 80th percentile of this set of data, right? So we have 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. And we think about it as the X percentile is the first value on the sorted list that is at least as large as X percent of the elements, or the 80th percentile is at 80% of the elements. So when you put, So when you put them in order, okay, the 80th one will be in position 4, okay, because it's like equal to or after the one that we're talking about. All right. So the first thing you have to do is order them, and then you take the right one, as it were. All right, so when it gets a little trickier, right, is if you have the wrong number of elements, right? And so if you want the 50th percentile of these 5 digits, then you get 2.5. So what you do is you round up, okay? So even if it was, and I probably should change this example, even if this was like, you know, came out to be, you know, 2.3 or whatever, you'd still go up, okay? I mean, let's see. Now my head's broken. I mean this number. How's that? Yeah. Yeah, I should probably try to make that clear. All right. So what's the 50th percentile? When talking about a set, the median is the number at the 50th percentile. So you probably all at some point learned what a median is. And so the 50th percentile. Anybody know what the answer is? Yeah. So the way I think about this is I was just thinking of it as the one in the middle. Do you have another? Yes, it should. Sometimes I have mistakes. All right. So I think we have questions. I think I thought the next slide was before this question, but all right. So what do you call something at the 50th percentile? Does anybody know who A is? Come on, really? Nobody? This is like when I used the joke about Common the rapper.
Who is it?
50 Cent. 50 Cent, yes. There was also a rapper who was then an actor who went by the name Common. So I used to work that into the jokes, bad jokes, mind you, pretty regularly. And then people stopped knowing who Common was, and I got very depressed. All right, gonna call it. Looks like we had at least one person choose 50 Cent. All right, so slightly different from the median. Sometimes. So even though I did the multiplication wrong, the it's still 4. I feel like this is wrong. I just said I think this is wrong. So one of the problems I have sometimes that I change the array and then forget to fix the rest of it. So yes, I think this is incorrect. So the median here is 5, right? And the percentile is 6. But why is the median 5, but it's not the percentile? Is because the median doesn't have to appear in the set, whereas the percentile has to appear in the set. Does that make sense? So apologies, I'm a bug. It's one of those things, it's like I find a bug and then I don't take, because I'm standing here lecturing and I don't take a note to go back and fix the bug. But there it is. It's been all around a complicated lecture there. So the pth percentile is the smallest value in a set. That is it in a set. Why do I keep saying set? That is at least as large as p percent of the elements in the set. And there's a function in the data science module that you've been using called percentile that you can use to calculate this and, you know, to make things a little easier. And we're going to show a demo of doing that. Does anybody else think it's like a billion degrees in here? Or is it just me? Yeah. I don't know if I can fix that or not. Oh, wait. There's a button. There's buttons that I can't do anything with. We could turn off the lights, but then everybody would be sleepy. All right. Yeah. Okay. So we'll do this question, and then we do the demo, I think. So the pth percentile is the what value in a set that is what as large as p percent of the elements. So for the nerdier among you, this appears to actually have an Ethernet jack in the bottom. So we can apparently connect to it and reprogram it somehow. All right, get those answers in. Talk about the demo, I think. All right, calling it. And looks like most people got it. So this is the kind of thing that's got, it's really like, got a very easy definition. So it's the kind of thing I tend to put on tests. But we're not gonna jump into these examples yet. We'll actually jump to the Jupyter Notebook and show some examples. So one of these days, what I want to do is, like, there's actually a way in Jupyter Notebook to actually make slides. So I could actually merge the two things together. But then I could actually have bug checking, right? So, which I clearly do not have right now on my slides. So let's see, gotta run this first. All right, so we're just gonna make this array that just kind of has some random numbers in it. And the first thing we need to do is we need to sort the data. Somebody have any wild guesses on how we might sort it? Yeah. The sort function, yes, that seems logical to me. So we have hanging off of NumPy or NP. We have sort, and then we can say X. And now we know how to sort it. And then let's figure out where the 55th percentile would be. I have another piece of code that can go in there, but I think it's too hard to explain, so I'm not going to bother. All right, so the way we figure it out, right, is we figure out what position we want. All right, and so if we do this, though, we're going to get a number that looks, that's not going to be, it's not a round number, right? So we need to do something with it, and so we're going to round it up. And the challenge here, right, is that we will want to write the code that will round it up. So we're going to say rounded equals int num. And then because the difference here, right, is we want to round up. So instead of just doing round, we have to say, okay, if it's greater, oops, than rounded. So what does this do here, right? Is that if I pass in a number and it has a decimal, what is the result going to be here? So if let's say the decimal is 2.2, what is rounded going to be equal to? Probably not the best label. 2, right? So basically what int does is just lops off the end, okay, or lops off the decimal portion. So what if it was 2.7? What would you get? 2, right? So it just lops it off. It doesn't actually round it. That's why I'm saying rounded is probably not the best variable name there. So what I can do, though, is I can say, okay, so if my inbound number is bigger than my actual number, than my lopped off number, then I can say, okay, rounded plus 1, right? And then I can return rounded. Anybody notice what looks like a bug here? Why does that look like a bug, even though technically it's not? Yes, but that's not the one I was looking for. That's me lazy typing. All right, so maybe it's obvious to everyone in here, and it just wouldn't be to me. Notice I say greater than, not greater than or equal to. And the reason I don't need to do greater than or equal to is because only if it's greater do I need to massage it, right? If it's equal to, then actually I can just use the number as it is because it's already equal to it. That makes sense? All right. So, oh, I thought I fixed this already. Oh, nope. So, yeah, you probably have this error too, just FYI. At some point, I changed the name of the variable. So basically what I'm printing out here, right, is what was the kind of the original value, right? And then what is it when I round it up? And then which number is it that we're looking for? Right? What's the percentile? What did I say? 55%? In our original data set here, right? So the first thing we do is we sort it, and then we have to do the position. Right? But to your earlier point, we have to subtract 1 from it because it's 0-based, not 1-based, right? That makes sense? Yeah. Yes, but if it's greater than, we want to go up by 1, and if it's equal to, we want to just leave it alone. Yeah, when I was saying it before, I thought I was explaining it poorly, so I apologize. All right, make sense? All right, I think this is like a little bit beating a dead horse, but, you know, it's weird, I think, because we've been using median thus far, and this is kind of like looks the same kind of thing, but it's not. And so it's kind of annoying. So let me just see. Yeah, so another way we could do this same thing, or it appears to be the same thing. So when you're doing these calculations, there's another set of functions that are called ceiling and floor normally, and ceiling is often shortened to ceil, and so then you get ceiling. This is, I should fix this code, but this is a little confusing because I'm doing the minus one here instead of here, and so that's why this is four, or sorry, this is three and not four. Does that make sense? Like, this is not doing the exact same code as that, even though it gets the same result at the end of the day. Actually, maybe I'll just fix it. Then it'll make more sense. Oops. Nope. Where are my fingers? I think that'll work. Yeah. So now it's doing the same thing. It's just where the minus one happened. Yeah. Because the value, the result we're getting is as if it was one based, but we have to do it against an array, which is zero based. So the position we're calculating is if you're counting them starting at one, but because we're not counting them starting at one in the array, we have to subtract one to move over a spot, basically. All right. And then obviously, the simplest version is to just use the percentile function, which is probably doing this on the inside, but I don't actually know. But we could easily go look if we wanted to. All right, so earlier today, so see if this is true for you. But earlier today, when I had this typed in like this, it couldn't find this file for some reason. So if you're following along, raise your hand if that's not working. I had to do the full path. It was kind of annoying. So what this is public employees in the U.S. are required by law to have all of their salary, or actually all of their income from the organization that they're paid by, be made public record. So on the Boston website, you can actually go download the salary of every employee of Boston, of the city of Boston. So in order to, you know, not kind of share the information too widely and to not get distracted by who these people might be, I just kind of made up employee IDs and took out all the personally identifying information, even though it is all actually public record. So the reason I pulled this up is because I thought we'd go through an exercise using some of the things we've been talking about lately, but talking about the salaries of employees of the city of Boston, to tie it back to my city hall stupid example. Okay, so how would we figure out who's making the most money? What do y'all think? Oh, back there. Yeah. So, actually, I meant to go through the data a little more. So you would be right if you knew how this data worked the way it seems logically that it should, but it doesn't. So most people, when they have a job or whatever, they actually get money from their job in a couple of different sources. You have your salary or your like regular pay, but then you'll sometimes have retro pay. So in other words, if you get a raise over the course of a year or whatever, often you get the raise on, let's say, April 1st, but you're told about the raise on the 10th, okay? You'll get retro pay for the 1st to the 10th because they don't want to start giving the money before you've been told you got the raise. So that's what retro is. Other is like literally other, you know, it could be anything usually. Overtime, certain jobs, you only have to work a certain number of hours. If you work more than those hours, you get like whatever your hourly rate is. Often it's hourly rate times a half again, but sometimes it's much more. I think construction workers in the city actually, if they're working overnight, I think they do 3x their hourly rate, which is kind of nice. Then you sometimes get paid when you're on because you're injured. This is one of the special cases in this set of data is that cops are in here, so police officers. Who here has seen a police officer at a construction site? Okay, that is referred to construction detail, okay? And so when you're doing that work, it's actually over and above your normal hours. And so that's what goes in this detail. I don't know what the Quinn education incentive is, but ultimately you end up with this total earnings. And so the correct answer is you want to sort by total earnings, not just by regular, because we want to know how much people are actually making, not just what they're listed on paper as making, if you understand what I'm saying. But you were largely correct, and I'm going to cut and paste to make this go a little faster. So I'm going to sort by total earnings with descending equals true, and then I'm going to show an error. And so now I see that detail money makes a difference, as does overtime. So a police lieutenant, a particular police lieutenant in the police department makes approximately $365,000 a year if you add up all the stuff that he makes money from, even though his listed job salary is just right around $146,000 a year. So pays to be a police officer in Boston. However, what we also want to know is, let's look at the lowest paid employees. And so we basically do the same thing, except we reverse the descending order. Except you notice here, right, this is where we talk about things like data cleaning, okay? Is that there's a whole bunch of people here who have, like, they made 38 cents in whatever year this is, which I can't remember, 2020. So those, we probably don't actually care about that in the, if we're trying to compare like highest paid salaries and lowest paid, highest paid income and lowest income, because clearly these are somehow special, right? Like, and does anybody here know what a substitute teacher is? Anybody have a guess? It sounds pretty obvious, right? So what's a substitute teacher? Right. So my suspicion is that this person is a substitute teacher, but in 2020 didn't actually substitute for anyone. But to keep them like on the payroll, they gave them 38 cents or something. So there's something weird going on there. So based on that, maybe we want to throw out some of that data because it's not interesting. So but I think this is not going to do it. We're just going to see the same thing, but slightly different. I thought I had another step before this step. But let's say instead what we want to do is look at the salaries in relationship to what's called minimum wage. So in other words, let's look at the people who are being paid near the lowest amount they can legally be paid. Okay. So minimum wage per hour in Massachusetts at the moment, and this is probably slightly inaccurate because most of this data is from 2020 and the minimum wage changed in the past couple of years, but we're just going to use it anyway for the sake of argument. But it's $14.25. When you are working a salary position, for the vast majority of cases, the hours per week is expected is 40, and the weeks per year is 52 is what you're paid for. Okay. So often people have 2 weeks of vacation per year. However, obviously, you're still paid during that period of time, so that's why your weeks of working is still 52. So from there, we want to calculate what is the minimum salary, right? And obviously enough, we're going to say min, nope, multiply that by hours per week, and then weeks per year. And assuming I typed everything correctly, that means that our minimum salary here is just shy of $30,000 a year. And so maybe what we want to do is look at the salaries that are near that and talk about that as the low salaries that are here. Sorry, I thought I was printing this. Let me just show. Oh my goodness. Sorts. All caps. So let's just do this. Yeah, you might be right. So let's reload the data set. And then I'm wondering if that number is too low. Yeah, okay. So so now this is the low salary, so this is all the stuff below minimum wage, whereas now we've fixed the actual boss, like the boss table, to only include at least minimum wage salaries. But now we can start to look at things like the median. And so when we talk about the median, we're actually talking about the percentile kind of from now on, okay? So like I said, they can be slightly different, but I guarantee is that the number we choose is in the set, but otherwise it's the same. All right, and then we want to know what the maximum is, which we expect that to be about 365,000 or something. Actually. Yep. And then the minimum. So we do the same kind of thing again. Oops. All right. And so our minimum. Now, so here's the question. Is our minimum exactly the same as the, the minimum salary possible? So that's 29,640, but our minimum is actually $4.27 more than that. Okay, so that's our percentile versus our, I guess it's not. No, never mind. So it's just the only one that appears in there is actually slightly over the salary minimum. Yeah. Any array is the idea, yeah. It does the sorting for you. All right. So now, if we want to get some more understanding of this data, right, we want to take, oh boy. We want to try to make a histogram out of it, but first we want to develop some bins for it. So does anybody have a recommendation about what bins we should use? So minimum, maximum, and then what do we want the step to be? That seems like too small. I think the one I used for my example is 20,000, but yeah. But yes, you get the idea, is that you want to think about, like, what's a logical grouping, right? And this may take 7, 10 tries, right? Till you figure out what makes sense. So, this isn't showing up terribly great, but you get the idea. So as you can see, you know, it trails off pretty fast. You know, most people are making kind of between our minimum, which was about 30K, right, up until about maybe that's 120,000 or something, 125,000, which is kind of what you'd expect. You know, I would say that seems like a reasonable range, but we definitely have some pretty heavy outliers out there. All right. Now, let's say what we want to do is start to try to figure out, can we make any kinds of predictions or understanding of salaries in the city of Boston based on this data set? Okay, so what we want to do is we want to take a sample of that data. However, so we're going to pull out a sample of it. And we're going to type correctly. And this time, we are going to do it. So in other words, we're going to guarantee that our 300 sample is only unique ones, right? So the reason I'm doing this is because I want to simulate, pretend like I can't actually go out and get the salaries for all the Boston employees. But I can, let's say, get 300 people to tell me what their total income is for last year, okay? And so I'm going to pretend I don't only have that data, but what I want to do is I want to start to make some guesses about what other employees might make. So that's what I'm doing here. This is not, I'm not pulling a sample because I want to do anything or I want to do something based on this original data set. I would just want to create it so that I can pretend that I don't actually have all the data. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So imagine, you know, instead of this Boston City employees, we were going and interviewing some organization that does not have to make their data public because we want to know something about how their salaries work or their income works, really. So, if I use percentile here, I can see where the center of that is. And it looks like the data I pulled from that sample, the center is about, you know, just shy of 90,000, which hopefully is going to be close to the actual population median, okay, so from my original data set. So basically what we're doing is we're kind of setting up a fake experiment, okay, so that I can show you how you can use a smaller amount of data to try to predict something about, like, the real population median. So the real population median is just shy of $97,000. So let me just see what I'm looking at next here. So what we can do is make a similar histogram as we did before. And as you can see, even though we have a much smaller sample, it actually looks pretty similar to the actual population distribution, right? But how do we prove that? Or how do we ensure that it actually does look like it? So anybody have any guesses as to what we would do to make it look or to kind of prove that it's similar to the real distribution, or how do we get to the real population distribution? Anybody on that side of the room? It's always this side of the room here answers questions. I feel like the lefties are being excluded. All right. You think you know the answer? You could, but what I'm trying to prove is that, so all I have is 300 samples, right? And we know that's probably not representative of the overall population distribution completely, or we're not sure. So what can we do to turn our 300 data samples into a larger data set? Any ideas? You think you have an idea? Yeah, go ahead. So you are definitely on the right track. So what we want to do is essentially pull medians, because what we want to do is we're going to try to find the actual medians in there and figure out how do we know what the median could be, right? As like a first step, kind of, okay? So we can do what we've done before, is we can pull samples of our sample, except we're going to pull of the sample size or whatever, and so we haven't gotten to that yet. So what we're doing here is we're trying to say, okay, how close, sorry, I missed the step. So how close is our sample to our original data set? And what's the error look like? Some days I need to read better. All right, so what I do is I just create a little function that will get me the sample, that will take a sample and get the median out of it. And then I call that. And as you can see, we have our sample median. And so now we want to know what, like, what's the difference between them, right? So we're going to just subtract them, and that's how we get our error. And so in this case, we just run that subtraction, and we see that our difference is about 1,100. And so that's kind of the first step, is just to kind of get an idea of how to approach this. But really what we want to do is we want to pull a whole bunch of samples and look at the medians, and then we want to create a new graph, right? So now we have, this is our minimum sample median, right? And then this is our maximum, which is, so 83,000, 108,000, and then the 50th percentile of our sample medians is 96,000. So that seems pretty close. Can't believe I missed a step. So our general population, which I can't remember what it was exactly, 96,762. And this sample, we're at 96,210 is in the middle, right? So we're getting, so this mechanism is getting a median that's pretty close to the real one. Does that make sense? So we know we're on the right track to try to figure out a way to test if our prediction technique is going to work right, is working correctly. So we're going to make another histogram, except this is of those sample medians. So now we know that this red dot right here, so this scatter line here is not really printing a scatter, it's really just printing a red dot. That's the real one. And as you can see, our samples are putting a median that's kind of in the right spot. Okay, it's getting near it, right? So we can start to get an idea of, okay, so this technique seems to be on the right path. But how do we check it for sure? How do we know how different it really is? Basically, what we want to start to do is we want to just do those same kind of subtractions. Oh, goodness. So I'm just going to copy and paste this because we're going to run out of time. All right. And so now we can see our minimum and maximum sample errors, and then the percentile of sample errors. So in other words, this is our worst, or kind of one end of the spectrum, our worst error of about being off by about $13,000. so our difference in the middle number is only about 552. Okay, so we're getting pretty close, which is pretty good. So what we can do next is let's look at it in terms of, instead of looking at the medians, why don't we actually look directly at the errors? Oh, shoot. Sorry. Battery low warning. Forgot to plug in my battery. Okay. So now we can see that, like, because at the end of the day, right, if we're trying to figure out what our, you know, how good our tool is, right, we don't actually care what the values are, per se. All we care about is how different is it from the real population. So, as you can see, our errors are actually, like, that's not too bad, right? I mean, if the top end of our range is 365,000 and the low end is 30,000, being, you know, most of the time, only about $1,000 off, that's pretty close, right? Yeah. Unless I can't read. $10,000 off, my bad. Yeah, no, I just can't read. So, but even so, like $10,000, still, that's pretty close, right? And maybe we can get closer. So, what that leads us to is, can we now generate, if we only had the 300 originally, is there a mechanism by which we can generate a bigger data set so that we can get closer than we were from the original? This is kind of where, like I said, I skipped a step, but then this is kind of where I was going, which is that we can use this technique called bootstrapping, where we're going to take our sample. So we're going to take our collected data, but we only had 300 of them, right? And we're going to sample that of size 300. But this time, we're going to replace with, we're going to allow replacements. See what else is missing. And we'll talk about, I think we're going to talk about the bootstrap more formally next time, but what we can do is we can now pull out what's called a bootstrap sample. So basically, it's one of those things, I don't know the etymology of this, so I don't know where it comes from. But basically, when you have a thing and you want to make more of that thing, it's often referred to as a bootstrap. And like I said, I don't know why, because it seems like a weird word to use, but that's basically what it means. So what we're saying is, okay, I got this data set of 300 that I went out and collected. I want to use that to bootstrap into more data so that I can make some sort of predictions about the general population of the salaries without having to go collect more data, right? Because as I keep saying, right, the thing that's really expensive here is collecting data. So anything we can do to turn our existing data into more data or more useful data is way better than actually collecting more data. Make sense? Yeah. Exactly. So that's what we're going to talk about more next time. But I'll show some more of this example. So what we do to bootstrap it is we pull those replacements, or we pull it with the replacements, basically because in this case, we don't care, like in the short version is, we don't care that about getting the same distribution of data as we did, or the same distribution of data from the sample. So we allow replacements because we're trying to show something else. Can't find my mouse though. There we go. So we're just going to kind of keep resampling. Sample. But because the defaults are in our favor, right? we want all of them, and we want with replacement, so therefore we don't have to pass any parameters at all. So now we have a little function that'll do the work, and then we do it 1,000 times, and then we print our results. So trying to figure out what the colors are. Okay, so as you can see here, right, that didn't do a great job, right? Because here's our real median. So this is the thing we're trying to model, right? This is the model from our samples, okay? Or one of our samples. And then, you know, kind of like, here's our data set. So what does that make you think we should do next? I think we'll do that, and then we'll talk about that a little bit. Yeah. Say that again. I'm not sure I follow you. So right now, what it's telling us is because we're cheating, because we know what the population median is, it's telling us that we're not doing it right. So what we want to do is something, probably something bigger, right? And then we should start getting closer, all right? All right, I'm going to pause there because I don't really have enough time to get into bootstrapping entirely, and it seems like we should talk about bootstrapping some more first and then talk about the example some more, which is fine. But I think there are a couple more slides I wanted to talk about. So these are just some of the percentile questions, which are just some examples. But I think we don't want to get too much further because we're almost out of time. Yeah, so we'll talk about estimate. Oh boy, not what I meant to do. How many times do I have to answer the same question? Go. Okay, so just some examples of percentile, and we'll kind of call it there. We'll start with Bootstrap next time, and then and talk about the estimations, and then confidence intervals, so we can start to figure out how accurate is our guesses.